Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Whoop, am I on? No, I'm not.
You are.
I am. Now I'm on. Great. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Victoria Bond, and I'm very happy to welcome you to Cutting Edge Concerts New Music Festival. I want to ask you to turn off. Microphone doesn't work. All right.
Can't hear you.
You can hear me anyway.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Okay. I will project my voice. At least I'll try. First thing I want to ask you is a practical one. Please turn off your cell phones or anything that makes noise. The second thing I want to announce is that we are reversing the program. As you can see, we have a very complex setup here. So we're going to be starting with the jazz ensemble, Miho Hazama's M unit. And I'm going to invite Ms. Hazama and two of the composers on the program in just a moment. But I just wanted to make sure that you understood this is not Paul Barnes here. Paul Barnes will be on the second half of the program. And now it gives me great pleasure to welcome onto the stage Miho Hazama. Scott Ninmer and Chris Reza. All right. Oops, I think you may have to jump rope with this.
Okay.
Great. Miho, let me start with you.
Okay.
This is a very unusual ensemble. It not only has the traditional saxophones and trumpet and horn and rhythm section, mm-hmm. but you also have a string quartet.
Right.
So what is your thinking about adding a string quartet?
I'm originally from Japan, and I've been studying classical music for a long, long time back in Japan. And then when I came here for the first time 4 years ago, actually 5 years ago, I started learning jazz composition at Manhattan School of Music. And at the time, Manhattan School of Music has a great, great big band. But as a person from a classical music background, I really wanted to have a symphonic sound that has a strings or a French horn and a vibraphone so that I can get a sense of the things that I've been learning so long.
Yes, and you know, the other interesting thing is that you have also the classical structure in your music. We're going to be hearing your music on the program. One of the pieces, Journey to Journey, is on your CD, and some of the pieces are premieres. I'll ask you about that in a minute. But I was very struck in listening to your rehearsal this afternoon, the beautiful combination between structure and freedom.
Thank you so much for the comment. I really well, there are like two perspectives that I as a composer that I have. One is for musicians and then entertaining things. So I always get ideas from specific musicians, such as, you know, great musicians here. So but the other hand, on the other hand, I also get a lot of logical ideas when I'm composing. So I think it's all a combination of my logical side and also like emotional side, and also classical music side, and then jazz music side, or sometimes rock music side, electric music side, and then of course identity as a Japanese person. You know, it's so interesting to stay actually living in New York City to see all the difference between Japan and the U.S. as well. It's been, Japan is obviously really far away from here. So, I mean, so many things are different, and I was so shocked when I got here 5 years ago, but it's been just, yeah.
You have, one of your pieces is about missing your home. Missing
really?
Your homeland. Yeah, there's a kind of nostalgia that you had written in your program notes.
Well,
yes.
I have to admit that that's naturally in my compositions because that's what I've mm-hmm. been getting from.
Yes, right. Yeah. And tell us a bit about the soloist who you've engaged, Steve Wilson.
I met him at the Manhattan School of Music. He was teaching in the school, and he has been one of my heroes all the time. So I talked to him after the classes, and then he has been so nice to be participate in the first recording that we had 3 years ago. And since then, we've been playing quite a lot of times whenever I have a chance to play with him. And then I mean, well, for me, he's a dream person as an alto saxophone player and then soprano saxophone player. He's amazing.
Yes. Yeah. Chris Reza, you are both a performing musician as well as a composer. And Chris is appearing right now in Fun Home. I hope you all saw today's paper. It had a fabulous review of the show. And Chris was in the show from the get-go. And his piece has a very interesting title and a very interesting dramatic situation, because I'm sure you're aware of the ice cream trucks in the summer, Mr. Softy. They have this sweet, tinkly little music. Well, Chris, tell us about the effect this music had on you.
Sweet. Yes. The first couple times you hear it, but whenever you live in a first floor apartment and it parks outside your window every day for an entire summer, nonstop. Sweet isn't the word I would use
maybe
to describe.
Maybe obnoxious?
Well, it was totally fine. And there comes a point when you're trying to, like, say, teach lessons or compose or practice, and the tune becomes a little intrusive. I remembered, in fact, trying to escape the Mr. Softy theme by putting in headphones and listening to, that summer, I remembered the jazz tune Eternal Triangle. And what this piece conveys is that memory of hearing Mr. Softy and then trying to tune it out by listening to some jazz. And these headphones were not isolating headphones, so Mr. Softy found his way into these phenomenal jazz solos. And this piece conveys not only that, but my growing animosity towards Mr. Softy and his theme song. But having said that, I will say I am a fan of the chocolate dip cone. Mm-hmm.
Scott, I'd like to talk to you for a second, because you also are a performing musician on trombone. Yes. And one of the interesting things about your piece today is that you have reversed the conventional having the melody on the top and the harmony on the bottom, mm-hmm. by putting the melody in the lower brass and strings also, mm-hmm. I think.
Yeah.
And you also have just acquired an awesome job as the President's Own, the Marine Band.
Yes.
Yes, as the principal arranger, chief arranger for the Marine Band. Very wonderful job. Yeah. Of course, it's taken you away from New York,
yeah.
but yeah. So. Tell us a bit about this piece.
Sure. Well, in talking to Miho, I realized that I could write for the guest soloist Steve Wilson, which I was very excited about. So I write a lot of big band music, and in my big band music, I usually keep fairly a lot of control over the forms and the melodies. And with this piece, I wanted to give him a lot of freedom to do whatever he wanted to do. So a lot of the piece isn't really, there isn't a whole lot of melody in a large portion of the piece. It's mostly just backgrounds and textures to give him something to play off of while he's soloing. So a lot of the piece is that. But there is, at the beginning, the bass instruments basically take all of the melody, because I figured Steve's soloing on soprano throughout the piece, so I thought as a counterbalance to that, it would be nice to have the melody on the bass instruments.
Excellent, so, excellent. Yeah. Miho, I have one last question to ask you, and that is the name of your ensemble. Is it M-Unit because of Miho?
Yes, it is.
Thank you all so much. We look forward to hearing your music.
Thank you.
now we're really, really honored to have a guest player. Please welcome Steve Wilson.
Thank you. Thank you.
horns, Kevin Collins on the wind one. Andrew Gavaskas on the wind three. Matt Dora on the trumpet and Bart Hill on the French horn. Strings. Tomoko Akaboshi on the first violin. Sarah Hoytnik, excuse me, on the second violin. And the Christiana Libre on the viola. And the Lindenberg on the cello. In the rhythm section, Alex Brown on the piano. Yuhan Su on the vibraphone. Sam Anning on the bass. As you can find it in the program, as you can find a postcard in the programs, we actually, the band, just had a recording a couple of weeks ago, and the album is going to be released in late September. So if you like, except the premiere piece, we played a couple of pieces from my last album, which was available at the bar. So if you are interested in, please take a look at it, and then hope you can enjoy more music. It's selling at the bar here in the intermission, and hopefully after the concert as well. And then if you'd like to check our new album out, you can go to the website and then check. We're gonna put a lot of photos and videos and updates there. So please stay connected with us. Thank you very much. And of course, one of the only, Steve Wilson. Yeah. So last piece is a piece from the last my first album, featuring Cam Collins on the saxophone and Steve Wilson on the saxophone, which is called What We Will See When You Turn the Next Corner. Hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to be presenting Paul Barnes, our wonderful pianist, on the second half of the program, originally on the first half of the program, and three extraordinary composers. I'd like to start with Lukas Floyd, and his piece is called Piano Thoughts. Lukas, come up here and tell me something about this. I know that these pieces are the result of some improvisations that you did, and they're kind of your musical thoughts. The first group, or Piano Thoughts 1, was several years ago, and then Paul asked you to do a reprise, and you went back into your trunk, as mm-hmm. it were, and brought out some thoughts and maybe some new thoughts. So tell us a bit about the process that you went through.
Yes, so I would say that these two pieces are sort of a reflection of what my compositional process is recently. So most of my writing will start kind of at the piano, just kind of making stuff up and recording myself. And, you know, for longer pieces, that'll be used as like a basis. But for these, just kind of have taken ideas that I like, that I like them as they are, just kind of short ideas, and refining them, going back and kind of setting them in stone, as it were.
Great, wonderful. Mm. And was Paul's playing at all an influence in your piano thoughts?
I would say yes, definitely. That's always a factor. In the first set, and that wasn't written for him, he played that last October, and that's kind of when I met him. Mm-hmm. But definitely, as I wrote this second set, a couple months ago, it was definitely in my mind as I wrote them.
We're going to look forward to hearing it.
Thank you.
And then I'd like to ask Zack Stanton, yes. And your piece has running 16th notes. It's a travelogue, but it has a sense of shifting scenery about it. Was this taken from the place that you wrote it, or some visual image that you had in mind?
Right, it kind of was. This piece I wrote in summer of 2011, I was in Maine, rural Maine. I guess a lot of Maine is rural, but this is very isolated Maine, which is very beautiful. And I was at this festival for a few weeks, meeting a lot of new musicians, and I happened to meet a pianist who was interested in collaborating with one of the composers there. And he said, I wish one of the composers would write me a piece. And I said, well, I'll write you a piece. That would be great. And because I only had about a week to write the piece, I just tried to jump with the first thought that I had. And the idea of running 16th notes being kind of a motor and thinking about going through scenery, I felt like was a way to kind of get into the piece. And it also allowed for me to keep a steady stream of thoughts going forward. And since I didn't have a whole lot of time to work out a map and a plan and how would I want this piece to grow, I just thought, I want to take a germ and let my mind kind of run with it and see where it goes. So the idea of being, it is following scenery, not specific scenery. It was just a general concept that I had as I wrote the piece.
The idea of travel throughout.
Exactly.
Great. Well, thank you. We're looking forward to it. And not last but not least, Jason Bahr.
Hi.
Your piece has influences from everything from Bartok to Scarlatti and Chopin. Tell us a bit of how this got started.
Sure. One of my great composition teachers, Don Freund, every year he writes he's a great guy, great composer. Indiana University, where I got my doctorate. He writes a piano prelude every year, and it's a really great thing to do, I think, especially if you're in academia. It gives you a chance to write something every year, get a piece finished. All of these works that are being presented tonight were written over the course of maybe one or two days, and usually
you're slow, right?
I know. But over over winter break, when you have a little bit more time to write, and that gives you it allows me to take a little snapshot of what I'm thinking about, if it's Chopin or Scarlatti or just sort of a place. It's really remarkable.
Or Bartok folk dances.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Those are great. And a lot of these have a connection with a particular pianist. So the Bartok was for Lisa Overholser, who's been a friend of mine for a long time from Kansas City, or the Whitehall Prelude. That's where my friend Paul Higdon lived, and he has these monstrous hands. He's a great pianist, just like Paul Barnes here. And so the Chopin connection seemed very natural for him.
Great.
Great. Speaking of Paul Barnes,
here
Paul,
he is.
Let's talk with you about
it's
this.
It's great to be at. Which have I been here six times?
I think it you is, have. Close yeah, to. Right.
It's been great.
Well, you're a champion of new music and have commissioned a lot of works and have premiered a lot of works. And yet, you also are very involved with traditional music, Liszt being a specialty of yours.
Right.
So tell us about how these worlds intersect in your work.
Well, it's interesting because with my impending mortality becoming closer and closer, and as I'm getting older, as you can all see, I wanted to take a little bit, you know, I really wanted to start focusing on supporting the music of younger composers, so that's why I'm playing a lot of your music. And these gentlemen over here I met at a festival in Los Angeles. And so I really did want to kind of combine all of the worlds that I work in, you know, and I love playing Liszt and traditional stuff. But with my remaining, you know, time that I have left, I really wanted to focus on helping younger composers and presenting their works. So I'm recording my 13th CD next
Lucky
month.
Lucky 13, mind you.
Yeah, maybe I'll call it the 14th. And it's called New Generations, and it features composers in their 20s all the way up, you know, to composers in their 70s.
Well, we applaud you for that. Thank because, you. Of course, Cutting Edge Concerts is devoted to the music of living composers, as you know. And we look forward to hearing you play. So
thanks
so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.